Around 50 million years ago, a small mammal named Indohyus scurried around the forests and through the waterways of what is now India. About the size of a cat or a raccoon, it wasn't a carnivore. Its teeth definitely show us otherwise, that it would have been eating the plants around this delta environment it lived in. It also didn't have the claws at the end of its feet that you would expect from something related to modern mammal carnivores, which include different things like weasels, cats, dogs, and even bears. Instead, its feet all ended in just two toes touching the ground. So what exactly the hell was it? Overall, small, two-toed herbivorous animals paint a very good picture of a very particular type of animal that's still around today. And these are the mouse deer, which are very small and many of which still live in very delta-like environments, much like the kind of environment that Indohyus was found in. So is that really just it? The same kind of story? Where, hey, this is the end of the video, we found out it's a mouse deer. Not quite. It does belong to the same large group, the Artiodactyls. This order contains many different members, some of which should be very familiar, like sheep, goats, and even cows. Although there's even more diversity beyond this that haven't been quite as domesticated, such as giraffes and even hippos. Because of this, there's a lot of diversity for us to understand and try and place Indohyus with it. So how exactly do we do that? A lot of the evidence for this has come from the chemical structures within the fossil, specifically different isotopes that help to indicate where exactly it was living and spending most of its time. An example of this is the oxygen 18 isotope, which in freshwater mammals is generally 2-3% lower than other animals that are living within the same environment. So for example, hippos would also have this 2-3% lower ratio of oxygen 18 in their bones and in their teeth. Indohyus also shows this behavior with the same amount of very small depletion of oxygen 18 in the teeth that were chemically analyzed for this isotope. So this means it would be spending even more time in the water than even the most aquatic of these mouse deer, things like the water chevertain. So how much like a hippo was it exactly? Obviously it's not that similar in size, but there might be other traits that we can try and trace. One of these was traced. Carbon-13 isotopes are generally different depending on what an animal is feeding on. Because of the way carbon cycles in an environment, animals that are feeding in the water normally are slightly depleted and have lower amounts of carbon-13 in their teeth and bones. Indohyus doesn't show this, which seems very counterintuitive if it was spending most of its time in the water. But hippos also don't show this because they leave the water to go feed on plants on land. So this makes it much more likely that Indohyus was quite a bit like a hippo in his behavior, leaving the water to go feed on land, but then returning to the safety of the water when it needed to. This isn't the limit of similarities to hippos, though, as there is another one, and it specifically has to do with what the animal was probably doing when it was actually in the water. And that's because Indohyus, like hippos, was thick, or at least had thick bones. The bones of Indohyus had very thick and very dense walls, and this is something we see in a lot of different mammals that go back to the water, including hippos, aquatic sloths, and even some otters. This is a very good sign that Indohyus spent a lot of time in the water, with these dense bones helping to lower its buoyancy so that it could sink even easier, as opposed to floating at the surface where it may have been an easy target for predators. This is also something, again, we see in the hippos, which use their dense bones to sink to the bottom of rivers and other bodies of water and punt along the bottom, or essentially gallop across the bottom of the water. This means that Indohyus wasn't just like the hippos for what it was eating and where it was spending its time, but also potentially in behavior, with these dense bones sinking the animal to the bottom of the waterway and allowing it to gallop across the bottom or punt along the bottom. Only Indohyus would again be much, much smaller than modern hippos, which show this behavior. So is that it? Do we finally have a good answer? Is Indohyus an ancestral hippo? Well, still no, and that's because of one particular bone that was found. Now, the exact story of this bone being found is also actually a rather fortunate one, and that's because the fossil experienced a lab accident. Imagine that you're the preparator for this. You're paid to try and fix up the fossil and clean it out of the rock around it. And you're using a scribing tool to just kind of very gently etch away the rock around it, and you slip a little bit, and you crack part of the skull. And you want to glue it back on, but the researcher who's in charge of this project comes, looks over your shoulder and says, "Hang on, this one ear bone is wildly, wildly important." Because that's what happened. An accident in the lab led to us finding a single ear bone that lets us know what exactly Indohyus is. Indohyus was found to have a very pronounced auditory bulla, a type of bone and growth that is seen in only one group of animals today in the entire world. The auditory bulla is a hollowed-out part of the bone in mammals, which helps to contain the internal parts of the ear. But Indohyus's was very unique, because it was big. It had very pronounced rim, and the tympanic membrane had completely turned to bone, something that's not seen in anything else other than one group. And to help show this, I have a fossil coming from one of these animals. So with my fossil, we can certainly say this came from an animal far larger than Indohyus, larger than a cat or a raccoon-sized animal. I can also tell you from this bone and what it comes from, that it's not an animal that has hooves today. So not a cow, not a deer. So what would you guess it might be? Maybe a rhinoceros or even an elephant? If it helps, I can show you an image of an even larger one of these. In fact, the largest of these. One study measuring these bones measured the largest of them at about 14 centimeters across, or about 5.5 inches. So compared to my fossil, you'd still need to add about 2 inches, or a little over 6 centimeters, in order to get it up to the size of the largest of these ear bones. And what animal has these largest ear bones? Well, it's the largest animal. Just end of statement there. It's the largest animal. It's the blue whale. Something you may not expect to have come from animals very much like Indohyus. Again, it's very small, the size of a cat or a raccoon. Now, while I've essentially told you what Indohyus is, it's one of the first whales, it's really not technically one of the first whales. Instead, if you have the family tree of whales and other artiodactyls, you'd have the lineage that leads to whales coming up. It would split, Indohyus would be here, and then cetaceans, true whales, would be on this side. But because Indohyus is so close to that split, we can say with a decent amount of confidence that the very first whales were probably a lot like Indohyus. And that's something very different than what we have for the early whale record. Animals like Pachycetus were already starting to show a lot of whale-like features. For example, they also had this ear, but they were also much more carnivorous than Indohyus would have been. And they also had the nostrils starting to migrate up the head, the same way that we see modern blowholes in whales today. What this means, what Indohyus shows us then, is that unlike what we thought when we just had animals like Pachycetus and the even later Amblocetus, early whales probably didn't evolve from animals eating meat on the shores of the water. Instead, they were probably evolved from animals that were much more like very, very small hippos, leaving the water for short periods of time to eat plants, and then moving back into the water where it was more comfortable and safer for them to live. It also means we can very confidently place whales within the artiodactyls, meaning that they are technically hooved animals. And so even with that clade including animals like giraffes, hippos, and literal black sheep, there's still one group within that order that is even more of an outlier. Everyone, thanks for watching. Accidents in the lab. It's not the first time that this has happened where an accident led to discovery, and it's not even the first time this has happened for whales. Pachycetus, which I mentioned in the video towards the very end, also had the same thing happen where they chipped part of the skull and went, hey, this has whale ears. So that's just an odd reoccurring theme of early whales, it seems. I want to give a shout out to the Patreons on Patreon, Steve Black, Madeline Lockyer, Sean, and Ertad. They were able to actually vote on Indohyus. I gave 4 options, and this is what they voted for. So we'll have some new options up for December if you want to join in, and you can vote on what animal we look at from the fossil record for what the hell is this, because there's some really weird things out there. Again, it is holiday season, guys, and there's still COVID flying around, so do the right things, be safe, take care, wear your mask, and don't go extinct.